And we you know, so we tried to limit the height. We have not been successful at doing that yet.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yes.
What do you estimate the time period is for effectively getting a rezone?
We've met with city planning already. They've kind of given us orders to try to come up with a plan of our own. We've talked to them about the urgency of rezoning. So once we meet with them and we can get them to commit resources, it will still take a while because it has to go through environmental review.
Robert,
yeah.
Right.
I want to just respond to
you. Okay.
That's an excellent question. How long will it take? You know, it's not just a question of time. It's been a little bit, and I've used this analogy before, it's been a little bit like the Wizard of Oz. We come, we bring them what they ask, then they ask for something else. Then they ask for the broom. Then they ask for this. Then they ask for the now, what they're asking for, which is what we're presenting tonight, is they ask us to rezone the neighborhood, to actually come up with a plan. Who among us are urban planners? No one, but we did it. And that's what we're presenting to you tonight, to get your input so that we actually have the best of all possible worlds. You want us to put together a plan? Well, sure, we'll do it exactly the way we want it. However, I have to say that I don't think it's just a question of the time frame of how long it takes to do this. It's a political question, and it needs a political response. And that's what we're all doing here tonight. Tonight, we're going to make our voices heard and say that we need a rezoning. So it's not just a question of bringing them the broom and bringing them this report and bringing them this whole zoning thing. It's a question of them deciding that this community should be rezoned, and then they'll do the resources. So you being here tonight will really, really help. And we have our council member here, our wonderful council member, Mark Levine, who's just going to speak to us for a few minutes and take a few more questions.
Okay.
Thank you, Lauren. Thank you, Robert, and the whole team. It's just so inspiring to see what this coalition has built and the turnout here tonight. There are events being canceled all over the city tonight because of the weather. And you all, despite that, have come out. I shouted at the same time when you were in the room. Give yourself a big round. And what the Morningside Heights Coalition has done in mounting this effort is just extraordinary. And I think it reflects the feeling we all have in this neighborhood. The visceral connection we have to the buildings, to the scale, to the physical environment, to the history, to the legacy, to the human scale, to the livability of Morningside Heights. It's so unique, and it's why so many of us love the community and so many of us choose to live here. And it's at risk. It's truly at risk. I don't know if it's mentioned tonight, but we do have one big victory under our belt that we can't share enough, which is the creation of the Morningside Heights Historic District. The signs are already up now in some parts of Riverside Drive. You can applaud for that too. It's 115 buildings. And all of you are really made possible. It is only a first piece of our effort to landmark Morningside Heights. But it's a great first start. But tonight's about the rezoning. And this neighborhood really is an island of vulnerability, surrounded by neighborhoods that have been rezoned in recent years in ways that have protected them. The Upper West Side up to 110th Street, as Robert mentioned, has been rezoned. Frederick Douglass Boulevard to the east was rezoned in a way that protects it. West Harlem, north of 125th Street, and other parts of 125th Street have all been rezoned. I'm sure many of you know this. When was the last time that Morningside Heights was rezoned? 1961. And I'm sure that it made sense in 1961, but the world has changed, and technology has changed, among other things. And you can now build very narrow, very tall buildings on lots that you never would have allowed that in 1961. And so many of the egregious out-of-scale tall buildings are following this very familiar format where they acquire development rights over a large parcel and roll it up and consolidate it and then go very, very tall in a very narrow tower. And that wasn't feasible based on the engineering techniques available in 1961. And now it is, so we're vulnerable and we're seeing it most egregiously in the two towers going up around Broadway and 121st Street. And the solution is a more modern rezoning that actually puts a height limit in. And you might think, well, doesn't all zoning already have a height limit? And no, it doesn't. Traditionally, rezoning limits floor area, but if you squeeze it into a narrow spot and go really tall, then the sky is literally the limit. And so we want a contextual overlay, I'm using the lingo here, for this community. That is essentially a height limit, so that we would never again see 35-story towers. And it should be a height limit that is contextual with what's already in the built environment here. That would be a dramatic change. We also want to trigger a requirement for affordability. Right now, developers can build purely luxury projects, and unless they're seeking some sort of favorable financing or tax benefits from the city or state, they can go all luxury. And that's happening now in the two towers that we're lamenting. But we also want to be able to trigger mandatory inclusionary housing in my age, which would require affordability. We can do this with the rezoning, with a modern 21st century update to the zoning for this community. It makes good planning sense, and we're pushing very, very, very hard to get this passed here. It'll be a game changer for the community. It is a political fight, largely. So is the historic district, by the way, right? Unfortunately, it's not about the merits. It's about political muscle, and you're building that muscle here tonight, and I'm using everything I got to push down to City Hall. And I think we can win this fight. And we really called their bluff when you all agreed to do some of the groundwork here, because they're used to saying to communities, well, if you want to do the legwork, fine, but otherwise we don't have the resources, and that often ends the process. But you guys are coming back with a lot of the legwork done, and it's something they can't ignore. And I'm looking to bolster this work with resources from the City Council's Planning Division. Typically, we only respond to mayoral proposals, but we want to do it differently now. I want City Council urban planners to help strengthen your effort. So we go, absolutely. We go into the city with a proposal they can't ignore. We're going to do this. There's no reason this couldn't be done in the next year. There's no reason. Barry might be explaining this a little bit, but the technical process for rezoning is only about 9 months. Once that clock is ticking, it's a 9-month process. So even allowing for a few months in a lead time to build out the vision, this could be done in a year. There's no reason it couldn't be. And you have my commitment to fight with you every single day until we achieve a safer, more secure, more rational, more human scale 21st century rezoning for Morningside Heights.
Thank you so much, Mark. It makes all the difference having a good council member and a life official in our camp, and you heard it here tonight, so thank you, Mark. I just also want to say that April Tyler from Community Board 9, co-chair of the Land Use Committee, and that Land Use Committee has been wonderful and helpful for us, and that they brought a resolution to the Cull Community Board, which passed a resolution that stated that we should be rezoned, and that's a very important political document for us, so thank you, April.
So, now we're going to get to the nuts and bolts, nitty-gritty meat and potatoes of the night. I'm Barry Weinberg. I am part of Morningside Heights Community Coalition. I also sit on April Tyler's committee on Community Board 9, the Housing, Zoning, and Land Use Committee. And so I'm sure that the Community Board will be a very good partner for us once the official Universal Land Use Review process, ULURP, starts. But what I'm going to be going over tonight is the block-by-block proposal that is currently the draft that we have before we submit to the Department of City Planning. And so, as Councilmember and Robert alluded to, the Upper West Side has been rezoned with height caps. Manhattanville and Hamilton Heights have been rezoned with height caps. The only place on the West Side where developers can now build out-of-context towers is Morningside Heights. So we need to change that, and that's what this plan sets out to do. As a little bit of background, this plan was drafted because the public was invited to join these town halls over the course of 2016 and 2017. People signed up for the zoning committee. The zoning committee met over the course of 2017, reviewed the priorities laid out in the Morningside Speech Report that Robert mentioned, and then the zoning committee met and went over each individual block in Morningside Heights, again, 110th to 125th, Riverside Drive to Morningside Drive, to consider the existing building's height and density, their potential for new affordable housing, and their impact on the surrounding neighborhoods. So where we are in this process is we are now gathering additional community feedback on this draft to improve it before it gets submitted to the Department of City Planning. And that's why everybody on their chair should have had a little index card and a pencil, and we would like your feedback on the plan. Especially useful to us is feedback on specific blocks. You know your blocks best. You have the most important input in this, and so we need to hear from you if there is something about the draft that you think needs to be edited. So, with that being said, we're going to walk through a little bit of zoning 101 before we get to the block by block rezoning. And you should have a handout that you got that goes over some of the basics of the terms we're going to be using. I will try to stick to very generic layman's terms like 17 stories or feet, brownstone level, tenement level, but we're going to.
Does anybody need one? Did anybody not get one up here?
Yep. So Kyle's coming around with that zoning handout. But in the meantime, I want to go over briefly height factor zoning, which is what Morningside Heights has now. Height factor zoning does not have a height limit on the buildings that can be built. So as Robert and the councilman said, as long as you have the air rights, you can build up to the sky. And frequently what that results in our community is towers. Towers like the one going up at JTS, the one going up at UTS, towers like the aerial towers to the south of us. And so we want to get rid of all height factor zoning in our district. We want to replace it with what's known as contextual zoning. Contextual zoning has hard height caps above which developers cannot build without applying for special permits and going through the community board and going through the Department of City Planning and the Department of Buildings, and that really acts as a check. They can't build as of right above that height cap. And so